Hello my dear students, this is Dr. Amita Tiri. DCA first semester students, we are going through the subject Essentials of IT and OS, unit number 1, that is Introduction to Computer. In this unit's part 1, I have already teach you about what is computer, what are the major characteristics of computer, and what is hardware and software. Today we are going to do study of part 2. Let us see the content first. Today we will see block diagram of computer and types of computer. As we all know, block diagram is the structural representation of anything. Block diagram means if you want to represent anything, any concept, any diagram or any machine, we can make block diagram of that, and we can discuss that with our client or with our student by using that block diagram. So the block diagram of computer, it gives you a quick review of the working principle of computer, from inputting the data to retrieving the desired output. Let us see. This is our block diagram of computer. Here we will see three important units. First is input unit, second CPU, central processing unit, and third one is output unit. Now let us see them one by one, that how this block diagram working principle is. The set of data or instruction is entered through input device in the form of raw data or binary data. As we all know that computer understand only binary format of information or data. So by the input unit, data enters into the computer in binary format. Then the instruction is processed with the help of the CPU and combination of control unit and arithmetic logic unit. So here the work of CPU is to process the data inputted from the input unit. Now computer system produces the output with the help of output devices, which convert retrieved binary data into human readable form. As we all know that human cannot understand the binary format, so it is the responsibility of our output device to convert retrieved binary data into human readable form. Throughout the entire process, the data is stored in the memory unit, either primary or secondary, depending on the size of data. Now, let us see them one by one. Input unit. The input unit consists of input devices such as mouse, keyboard, scanner, joystick, etc. These are used to input information into the computer system, and like any other electronic machine, computer takes input as raw data and perform necessary processing and giving out processed data. The input unit is the medium of communication that takes data from us to the computer in an organized manner for processing. Functions performed by input unit. So input unit converts the inputted data or instruction into binary form for further processing, and it transmits the data to the main memory of the computer. These are the functions which input unit perform. Next, second, central processing unit or CPU. It is known as the brain of computer system because everything which we are inputting to the computer, it has to go from central processing unit. It is the whole sole responsibility of CPU to process this whole data. Okay, and all the operations which are going to be done in computer, all major calculation operations, they all are performed inside the CPU, and they are responsible for handling the operation of several units. We can see here how it looks like. CPU, you can see, okay, three parts are here: control unit, arithmetic and logic unit, and memory unit. Now the functions performed by central processing unit. The CPU controls all components, software, and data processing of the computer system. The CPU takes data from input devices, executes the data, and sends output to the output device. CPU processes all the operations, including all the arithmetic and logical operations. As we seen that CPU is divided into three parts. So first part is control unit. As the name suggests, the control unit, obviously it controls all the activities and operation of computer. Responsible for controlling input, output, memory, other devices connected to CPU. Means we can say that it is responsible for controlling hardware. It acts like the supervisor. Okay, as the supervisor work, so it determines the sequence in which computer program and instructions are executed. Further, it retrieves instructions from memory, decode the instruction, interpret the instruction, and understand the sequence of tasks to be performed accordingly. It further transmits the instruction to the other parts of computer system to execute them. So, in short, we can say that control unit determines the sequence of operation to execute the given instructions. Second, arithmetic and logic unit. So, the data inputted through input device is stored in primary storage unit. We all know this thing. So here the work of ALU comes in existence. So work of ALU is to perform all the arithmetic and logical operations. It performs simple operations such as addition, subtraction, division and multiplication. The logical unit controls the logical operation such as AND, OR, EQUAL, means decision taking operations, they are performed in logical unit. And apart from this, logical unit also responsible for performing several other operations. As the name suggests, arithmetic and logic unit. So arithmetic unit performs all the arithmetical tasks and logic unit performs all the logical tasks. After completing the operation, the result is either returned to the storage unit for further processing or getting stored. Third one, memory unit. So, memory unit is an essential part of computer system which is used to store data and instruction before and after processing. The memory unit transmits the information to other units of computer system when required. Further, we will go to memory unit. There are two types of memory unit. One is primary memory. The primary memory cannot store the vast amount of data. The data stored in primary memory is temporary. The data will be lost if they are disconnected from the power supply. The primary memory usually stores the input data and intermediate calculation result. It is also known as main memory or temporary memory, and RAM and ROM, these are the example of primary memory. Secondary memory, here it is necessary to indicate that by using the primary memory, it is not possible to store data permanently for future access. So if we want to store our data for future access, then we have to use secondary memory. Okay, the data stored in secondary memory is safe when there is a power failure or no power supply. It is the plus point here. Hard disk is usually considered as a secondary memory. So let us see what is the relationship between these two, because primary memory is necessary and secondary memory is also necessary, but the relationship which show that how they all, both of them, they all depend each other. So let us see. Primary memory is the only memory that is directly accessible to the CPU, and secondary memory is not directly accessible to CPU. This is the point to be indicated. Okay. The data accessed from secondary unit is first loaded into RAM and then further transferred to processing unit. The use of different memory units depends on the size of data. Next, now after CPU, we go to the other important unit of our block diagram of computer, the output unit. It consists of devices that are used to display the result or output of processing. Some of the widely used output devices are monitor, printer, and projector. Now, what functions output units will perform? So, the output unit accepts the data or information in binary form from the main memory of the computer system. So, here we can see that when we were inputting data, so that data will be converted to machine or binary format. Now, because human cannot understand machine or binary format, so it is the whole sole responsibility of output unit that it should convert the binary data into human readable form for better understanding. Now, let us move on to the second topic, types of computer. So, we can categorize computer by two ways. First, data handling capabilities, and second, on the basis of size. Now, first we will see the category on the basis of data handling capabilities. According to this, there are three types of computer: analog computer, digital computer, and hybrid computer. And on the basis of size, we can see supercomputer, mainframe, mini, workstation, and microcomputer. First, analog computer on the basis of data handling. So, analog computers are designed to process the analog data. Analog means it cannot have discrete value. Analog data is continuous data, okay, that changes continuously and cannot have discrete values such as speed, temperature, pressure, and current. Analog computer measures the continuous changes in physical quantity and generally render output as a reading on a dial or scale. Analog computer directly accepts the data from measuring device without converting it into number or code. Some of the examples are speedometer, mercury thermometer. These are the examples of analog computer. Let us see the examples of analog computer. You can see here. Okay. Next, digital computer. It is designed to perform calculation and logical operation at high speed. It accepts raw data as digits. Obviously, it is digital computer. So, it accepts data in the form of digits or numbers. All modern computers like laptop, desktop that we use at home or office are digital computer. Let us see how it looks like. So, this which we are using in day-to-day life, these are all digital computers. Hybrid computers, obviously, it has features of both analog and digital. It is fast like analog and has memory and accuracy like digital computer. So, it is consisting the features of both the computers. It can process both continuous and discrete data, widely used in specialized applications. For example, a processor is used in petrol pumps that convert the measurement of fuel flow into quality, quantity, and price. We all are aware about it. So that we see in petrol pump, that is a hybrid computer. These are the examples of some hybrid computers. Okay, as you can see in our car, in our system, computer system, and in specialized cases we use hybrid computers when we need the features of both analog and digital. Now, types of computer on the basis of size. First, supercomputer. As the name indicates, super. Okay, these are the speediest computers compared with all other computers which have fast, amazing speed or storage limit. They are expensive and require gigantic space. They are called as supercomputer. We need to accommodate a large air-conditioned room here if we want to maintain a supercomputer, then we need a lot of accommodations for that. So it is out of range from the common people. They are used only for specialized purpose and for large institutions, huge institutions. A desktop microcomputer processor process information guideline in a millionth of second at time in microsecond. So the supercomputer can play out a speed of nanosecond or even picosecond. As we have seen before in our part 1 lecture, that speed of computer is measured in the parts of second. So our desktop is working in millionth of second, but our supercomputer can play out a speed of nanosecond and picosecond. Just imagine the speed of a supercomputer. Amazing. Let us see some of the examples. Today's China's Tianhe 2. It is the world's quickest and fastest supercomputer, and it can perform 100 petaflops. China has built up the quickest supercomputer of all time. It has around 37, while the USA has 233. India has also built a computer, supercomputer called Param 10,000. IBM Deep Blue. This is also a supercomputer. It is designed for playing chess. The speed of supercomputer is million times quicker and faster than desktop PC. There is a speed is measured or counted in flops, floating point operation per second. Okay, if we want to measure the speed, then what is the speed measurement here? Flops. It can perform a speed of over 1 million per second. Generally used as a part of complex scientific application, as I told you before, that in specific applications it will be used in our day-to-day life, or an ordinary person cannot afford that computer. For a specialized purpose like complex scientific application, climate determining, monitoring tremor or earthquakes, we will use supercomputer. This is the example of a supercomputer. You can see the picture here. It is the fastest supercomputer, Tianhe 2. Types of computer on the basis of size. Now we will see here, we already seen this point. Now mainframe computer, they are gigantic in size. Obviously, as supercomputer, they are also gigantic, means very large in size, quick, extremely costly and expensive. They are not as quick as supercomputer, but still they are exceptionally costly. As we all know this thing, that supercomputer are the costliest computers today. But mainframe computers, they also fall in this category. They also gigantic in size, quick, extremely costly, expensive. But the speed, when we talk about speed, it is not quick as supercomputer. They are planned and created to process an incredible amount of information and data, and they can store billions of information or data. They can store and process a tremendous amount of information. They support more than 1,000 remote computers and can work as a host for different and multiple OS. Some examples are IBM Z890 and Hitachi's Z800. You can see how it looks like. Next, mini computer. They are called as mid-range computers and were produced in the 1960s using transistors, central memory technology and innovations. They are quite smaller in size. They are less expensive, speedier, yet not as quick as mainframe or super. So in comparison to mainframe or super, mini computer are not very fast. They are utilized or used as a part of private company organization and in the production department to monitor the screen, the manufacturing process. They help multi-client operations. They have very difficult operating system to deal with. Function as host in a system where 100 terminals are supported. The effective and powerful mini computers are super minis. They are called super minis. So we can see here that mini computers, they are used normally in specialized divisions. Okay, like private company organizations, productions, department, okay, to monitor or screen the manufacturing process. They are mid-range computers. Some examples are VEX and Texas Instruments TI-990. Here you can see how it looks like a mini computer. Types of computer on the basis of size, let us continue. Workstation. Workstation is a single user computer that is designed for technical or scientific applications. It is faster microprocessor, large amount of RAM and high speed graphic adapter. So generally it performs a specific job with great expertise. And they are of different types, such as graphic workstation, music workstation, engineering design workstation. So we can say that workstations are subject specific. Okay, they are also working as expertise in expertise field like music, graphics, engineering design. We can use different types of workstation computers. You can see here how it looks like. Then microcomputer, most commonly it is called personal computer. So we, the people, normal peoples, we are using here. They are the smallest and cheapest as compared with mini, and despite this they are widely used among people and end user client, and low cost. Because of its low cost, they are so small and they can kept on a table. Their users can be anyone. Okay, today we can say that a microcomputer can be used anywhere by anyone. Okay, it can also be used at workstations also. We can make it a small server also. So a microcomputer works in variety of ways. We can use it in a variety of ways. Some examples are microcomputers, desk PC, laptop, desktop computers, PDA, tablet PCs, etc. An important thing, its speed is measured in megahertz and gigahertz, and they have an input unit which encourages the user to give instruction to control unit, and an output unit which performs display information in desired or wanted form. As we know this, that with all our PCs we work like this only. We are giving input and we wait for the input to be processed and then output will be displayed. So let us see some of the microcomputers example. Desktop computer, as the name indicate, these are the single user computers. It can be fit on a desk. Okay, it means table. They are small in size. They are designed for single location and with a single user. Desktop are also called personal computers. Some famous manufacturers who manufacture desktop computers are Dell, Compaq, IBM. You can see here how it looks like. Laptops, as we all know, we all carry laptop computers. Okay, so desktop computers cannot be moved from one place to another. So here it gives the requirement for laptop, means a computer which can be movable from anywhere, from one place to another, any place we can take there. So they can perform with AC or with battery. Okay, these computers are usually used by person who have worked from one location to another, not as PC which is fixed to one place as they need AC power to operate. as I already indicated this thing, that if we want to take that from one place to another, so for that purpose this laptop computer are very useful. There are wide range of people who use this type of computers daily, maybe engineers, students, lawyer, businessman, teacher, graphic designer, salesperson, etc. Okay, the biggest asset of laptop is their mobility. So some popular companies who manufacture desktop laptop computers are Dell, Compaq, Toshiba, Lenovo. It looks like this, you can see in the picture. Next, palm top computer. They are very small size device, palm, as we all know this. It can fit in our palm. The user can attach mouse and keyboard also to work comfortably, and they can perform each and every task as personal computer and laptop. They have a graphical screen, okay, and you can do all the things which you can do with your ordinary computer or laptop in this palm top computer. So they are utilized mostly by businessmen, marketing executives and so on. Some of the important famous palm top manufacturer companies are Apple, Dell, Toshiba, etc. Here how it looks like, you can see here. Tablet PC. Tablet computers are called notebook, and they enable client to communicate utilizing computerized pen or fingertip without utilizing a mouse or keyboard. So here we can say that touch technology introduced, okay, in tablet PCs. They are smaller in size than our laptops, and using touch screen we can operate this using touch technology. So we don't need a mouse or keyboard. They all are removed from the picture now, and now we can work anywhere. They cannot satisfy the functionality of PC or laptops. So here are some limitations also with tablet PCs. So in today's lecture we have seen many important points of related to computer fundamentals. In next class we will see generations of computer and many other topics which are left from unit number 1. I hope you understand all the topics of this lecture. Thank you very much for listening.